I'm going to end at least the substantive part of our presentation by the following, which is again to reinforce my response to Commissioner Fish. Not only have we had access to information, and that has been something that we have been benefited by throughout the course of our relationship with the city, but the Bureau also makes itself available as we have questions during the review process that aren't about information that isn't reflected in the documents. So when we are asking or have questions about a certain training process, when we have questions about the way in which things were done that may not have been fully documented, when we have questions about the protocols of the Bureau, all we need to do, and this has been true for years now, is simply find the right person to ask the question of, and the Bureau has been very responsive in providing helpful information to that effect. Oftentimes, what we will end up doing is saying, well, we wish you would have documented that, but it's been very helpful and productive. The other thing that I wanted to also reinforce is that our process is that, and when we are done with our initial findings, recommendations, and reflections, we have the opportunity to share that information with the Bureau prior to publication. And what we have found is that's been a very helpful dialogue for us. We're not perfect. We don't always get everything right. And that dialogue isn't intended to change the thrust of our recommendations, but more to make sure that for all kinds of purposes, including the fact that facts matter, I still think facts matter, that we ensure that we are as accurate as possible before we release our findings to the public.
I wanted to add one more thing about the Bureau cooperation, and that is, I will regularly interact with sergeants or even officers on the Bureau who are very open and candid and clearly have gotten the message from their superiors up the chain of command that they're allowed to talk to us and they're allowed to interact with us freely and to share their viewpoint and their perspective. And that's important. Many organizations we work with will only deal with, you know, captains and above, and officers are too sort of nervous to talk to us or feel constrained, and that's not true in this Bureau, and I think that's an important statement about the tone that the command structure has set.
Commissioner Fish.
We have the benefit of having some written testimony that's been submitted in, course of this hearing, we may from time to time refer to some comments made by members of the public to give you an opportunity to respond. In the League of Women Voters submission, they focus, among other things, on recommendation number 5. I'd like to take a moment to look at that. This has to do
testimony?
With providing medical attention to an injured individual. And as the League points out, this is an issue that has been discussed and reviewed now for a long time, back to 2001 or before. In your recommendation, you address the question about the need to render coordinated first aid as soon as possible, and that certainly makes sense, and should not instruct paramedics to downsize its response team in the interest of not disturbing evidence. So can you flush that out a little bit? I can imagine a number of scenarios where someone might be concerned about bringing a paramedic in. Active shooting or other contingencies, but this question about the interest of not disturbing evidence. So how do you make that judgment, and what are the parameters? And when you say as soon as possible, can you put some boundaries on that and give us a sense of what kind of urgency you think should be brought to this question?
Absolutely, Commissioner. This is an issue that has been part of our dialogue with the Bureau and with the public, the community, and with you all for years. And what we have seen, important for contextual reasons to talk about what we saw when we first got started, we saw a number of cases in which after an individual had been downed by gunfire, Bureau personnel on scene would take a step back, you know, and then call the SWAT team or the CERT team, which is your version of SWAT, to respond, which could take, usually at least takes an hour and could take longer. So we have a situation where somebody was not moving, no showing, no signs of life from the perspective. CERT is called because there may be a weapon close by or what have you. And it would take a long, long time before that person would receive medical attention. It certainly, we don't see that anymore, fortunately. But we still do see, in one case, we highlighted this in our discussion, where the individual was down, the officers eventually used a ballistic shield, which is a new device that keeps them safer and allows them to approach, and consistent with an earlier recommendation we made. They come up with a ballistic shield, they handcuff the individual, so that once the individual's handcuffed, he's much less of a threat to them, and then they back off and call paramedics. But the instruction given to paramedics was, we only want two of you there, we don't want you, we want to make sure that we only want two there because we don't want shell cases to be disturbed or any other evidence or the gun that the individual had, which is understandable, but in our view, rescue predominates over any need to disturb evidence. These cases are not whodunits. They're really about state of mind. Shell cases get kicked around all the time when there is an emergent need for paramedics to respond. So in our view, that it's really critical that particularly scene supervisors, sergeants who get on the scene immediately, instructed that has to, the need to provide medical attention needs to predominate over any concern about the sanctity of the evidence.
And it's fair to say that's a national best practice?
It is, indeed. And it's something that sometimes it's difficult for officers to transition to. You know, to go from tactical mode, where they've just used deadly force, to rescue mode, where they now are seeing an individual and now have to find ways to either render first aid themselves or get the paramedics there, it's important. To the credit of this incident that I'm talking about, the paramedics had been called and were allowed to stage nearby, but the instruction was only bring two folks in because we don't want you to disturb evidence.
Sir, does this relate back to what you said earlier about the cautionary flag about sergeants excessively engaged in the tactical side rather than being directors?
In part, although in this case the sergeant hadn't been tactical, but certainly we think that he, and whether he in this case, really needs to be further guided about what's most important here, sanctity of evidence or preservation of life. And I think we can all agree that best practices say, I think we can agree that life preservation is most important. I think that the officers on scene had a sense that the individual is beyond saving, but it's not their decision to make. That's a medical decision.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I did a little research in sort of our conversation on this the other day. It turns out that all officers are, in fact, trained in the deployment of tactical shields. That was part of the 2017 in-service training. And they're actually more widely distributed than I expected. Every sergeant's vehicle has one. And so, there's probably some training education improvement that has been made since the cases that you're reviewing for this report, and I just wanted to make note of that. The most controversial issue here in terms of getting a response was on this question of supervisory responsibility, particularly on the part of sergeants approaching the scene. And I got unvarnished feedback from which within the Bureau, and there were a couple of refrains. And the first is really on us. It was a question about resources and capacity. And ultimately, the council controls resources and capacity with regard to how many people are on the scene and how many people are available to actually be engaged at a tactical level versus a supervisory level. And the second was, I would generally characterize it as concern about being too prescriptive with regard to the role of the supervisor on scene. And what was mentioned to me was a specific case around communications where it was believed that really only the sergeant could handle the communications under a certain circumstance. And the question was raised, are you actually going to prescribe that the sergeant not be engaged in that function? And potentially, if you write it into policy, require remedial action from the sergeant as a result. How would you respond to those responses to the issue that you raised?
There are a couple ways to respond. I understand that writing something into policy and sending it, you know, it's not always good to create hard and fast rules that have no, that officers have no ability to exercise some discretion to veer from. There might be exceptional circumstances. I understand that sergeants become sergeants because they're good officers. They did their job well, they're smart, they know what they're doing, they have experience. And sometimes it's hard for them, once they become a sergeant, to step back from that thing that they're very good at. And they know they're on the scene and they think, I can do this better than this new officer. And that's a difficult position to be in, I get that. At the same time, if you don't give those officers the chance under your supervision, they're not going to learn to become the good, experienced officer that you had the chance to become. So I get that there are circumstances under which, you know, you might want a sergeant to step in, and they need to be able to recognize that. Should a policy completely remove all discretion? Probably not. I mean, we haven't suggested any particular wording for this policy. It's just the recommendation to reinforce this through training and accountability hasn't changed a lot. So the idea of having a policy was a recommendation in this report.
Very good. If I could shift gears, any of my colleagues want to talk, please just do. I want to talk about the timeliness of investigations. And as a new police commissioner coming in and realizing that I was being asked to look at investigations that were quite old, and in communicating with lots of people who are different parts of the process, everybody seemed really frustrated by the length of time it takes to complete an investigation. Could you elaborate on your findings and recommendations with regard to timeliness of investigations? And first of all, let's just stipulate that it's in the interest of the officer, and it is interest of the individual who was the recipient of officer use of force, and their family to have this done quickly. So what are you recommending, and given our current structure, what would you change?
I think that timeliness is always needs to be balanced with thoroughness, and certainly we don't want to, and we're not intending to recommend that the thoroughness of the investigative process and review process that occurs in Portland be somehow subverted. On the other hand, it is important that these kinds of investigations be completed. The DOJ, the Department of Justice, said so, and that was part of the settlement agreement regarding ways to collapse the time, if you will, in order to have more timely investigative and review process. And I think it's a large part of that kind of oversight that currently exists here. The Bureau has done better, significantly better. That being said, there are times in which files seem to end up on people's desks for too long with not a lot of activity going on. So I just think that we don't have a specific recommendation or magic cure or magic bullet that plagues every agency that has these responsibilities. And it's a fact that there's plenty of work to do for people who may not have enough resources to do it. It's an explanation, not a justification. And I just think that it's important for, and we're going to continue to watch it, but I think it's important for the management of the Bureau to continue to figure out ways to collapse that process without sacrificing the thoroughness
and the robust review process that's currently.
So there were two recommendations that you may have not stated explicitly, but you certainly implied them. So I want to find out if that is true. The first regarding the question of internal affairs. And you stated explicitly at the head of that section that internal affairs, generally speaking, is not a bottleneck, but it becomes a bottleneck if somebody or a part of the process later on asks for additional interviews or follow-up information. And there is a competition for time, energy, and resource back at IAA for the follow-ups. And you seem to be suggesting that it's not the initial IAA investigation that is a problem, it's follow-up requests that are becoming problematic. And you've got a recommendation there. First of all, did I state the problem accurately? And if so, what is your recommendation?